Hi, I'm Avery Davidson. Thank you for joining us for This Week in Louisiana Agriculture, the only TV show bringing Louisiana farmers and consumers together every week. There are more than 3,200 black farmers in Louisiana, according to the 2017 USDA Census of Agriculture. That said, black farmers only make up about 7% of the state's farming population. While this group may be small, the Natural Resources Conservation Service is working to provide them and all farmers with programs to convert land from one use to another while also helping the environment. Fillmore Larkins is going check on newborn calves on his farm in Palmetto. Raising cattle is a second career for Larkins.
Hell, I was 40 before I stood beside a cow. My cow always came on a plate.
And Larkins used to serve up that beef to inmates. You see, he's a retired security officer who revamped the food service system for the Louisiana Department of Corrections. That begs the question, which is harder to handle, a bull or an inmate?
Well, inmate has understanding. The bull don't understand nothing.
What Larkins understands very well is that he could not stop being active in retirement.
A lot of people retire and just sit around and die. I'd rather them find me in the field than sitting in the couch.
So this field is where Larkins spends much of his time. When he acquired the land, it was a soybean field. So he contacted Natural Resources Conservation Service District Conservationist Joshua Swallow to help him make a plan to convert the land to a sustainable pasture.
Out here, Mr. Fillmore did Bermuda grass to establish a permanent forage, improve the grazable forage for his cattle, water to get water out here for them. We worked with them to put in a water well and pipeline, troughs, heavy use pads to protect those areas, and then cross fencing to divide it up into pastures to allow for rotational grazing.
The land is the only thing that we have. And if you don't take care of it, it won't take care of you.
And it is taking care of Larkins and his family. He says with rotational grazing, the cattle cannot eat faster than the grass grows.
It's definitely a partnership because our programs would not exist if it weren't for private landowners like Mr. Fillmore voluntarily signing up to implement these programs. We're bringing the technical knowledge to it, but they're bringing the land and the resources to it to implement it.
Larkins is part of a small percentage of black farmers in Louisiana, and he recalls times when finding partners was not this easy.
The economic challenges are still there, but you can overcome them. You must learn and outperform and show that you have the ability to do what you say and have a plan. Any plan is better than no plan because you can correct a plan, but you must have a plan.
It's a plan he's corrected several times, but Larkins knows the only constant is change.
You know, a lot of people fight change, which is normal, but we still have to try.
Larkins is hopeful his grandson will continue the farm. If you would like to learn more about how the NRCS can help you, visit our website at twilatv.org or click the link under this story on YouTube. Right now, we are in the middle of what the 4-H world considers livestock show season, which culminates Mardi Gras week at the State Livestock Show. This week, we introduce you to a 4-H agent from Ascension Parish who loves this time of year as she sees her students shine.
The livestock show season is definitely one of my favorite seasons throughout the year. The livestock exhibitors have been working with these projects all year long, and the livestock show is where the exhibitors get to come and show off that hard work. That's really the rewarding part of all of this, is getting to see the kids in action and really working together and accomplishing things. My name is Camille Brady, and I'm the 4-H agent here in Ascension Parish. This is our parish livestock show, which is one of the first shows in a series. So basically, our 4-H members and FFA members come and bring their animals to parish. Then they go on to the district level, and then if they qualify, then they are able to go on to that next level and compete at the LSU Ag Center State Livestock Show in February. Livestock is definitely a year-long process. You can't just start working with your animal the week before and then show up at the parish livestock show and expect to do well and have your animals cooperate. These exhibitors are at home every day, waking up in the morning and feeding their livestock, They get home from school, they go back to the barn and feed again. They have to groom them daily. They have to walk them and brush them. It teaches them about work ethic and responsibility. All the work is really put in at home. And then when you get here at the show, it's more of like a celebration and a show off of your hard work and your efforts that you've previously made. Livestock is not a team sport, but I like to kind of consider it as one. When you walk through the show barn, you see exhibitors helping other exhibitors with their livestock projects, giving them tips, being a mentor. Growing up, I showed livestock, I showed cattle, and I also showed swine. Being a 4-H agent, this is my favorite time of the year. And I think back to my livestock days and those friendships and those connections and that networking and that work ethic that it's taught me has really helped me to get to where I am.
Thanks to the LSU Ag Center communications team for that story. The State Livestock Show is happening this week at the Lamar Dixon Expo Center in Gonzales. Last week, TWILA's Carl Wiggers introduced us to a farmer's market in St. Helena Parish in the town of Greensburg. This week, he takes us back to meet a couple of vendors who sell their homemade goods and healthy, fresh produce to the community.
Farmers markets often offer more than just fresh fruits and veggies. You sometimes find some great characters, like Miss Ruthie.
What you want to know?
All right, so what all do you have?
Well, let me start. First of all, we have the pole skins. I normally have them in 5 different flavors. I do my own cracklings and do the pralines. I have pecan pralines, walnut pralines, and I also do the bourbon pralines. Homemade sweet potato pie from yours truly, Miss Ruthie, down with the tea cakes and the crackling cornbread.
You'll also find some goodies in jars.
I do some pickled squash, some pickled okra. I do the muscadine, chow chow, pickled yard eggs, pickled green beans, and also the apple jam.
You can find a huge variety under Miss Ruthie's tent.
You're a busy woman.
Yes, you got to be in this world. You better be a jack of all trades. That's me, Miss Ruth. A little of this and a little of that.
However, if you're looking for fruit and vegetables, you can visit Alton Cryer's tent for a huge selection of fresh produce.
Right now in season, greens and more greens and root vegetables, so turnips, beets, strawberries are in season. They actually have been in season since November. They go out of season like in late April. That's when the Strawberry Fest is in. So we grow a lot of turnips, a lot of mustards, a lot of rutabagas.
Burnell Muse works with the Southern University Ag Center and says his focus is bringing local produce to the market.
You know, working in a small town, and you know, you talk about the farmers markets in the big city, a lot of people say, well, everybody in the country raise their own food, but they don't, you know, so they're looking for food as well, you know, and you know, small garden in your backyard, it takes time, and equipment is expensive. So if you can come and you know, they can get vegetables at a fair price, you know, save some money and get a good nutritious food, and it's fresh. Our food is fresh. It's either picked the day before or the morning before the market.
Cryer says shopping for fresh food safely is a big draw for locals in these extremely important markets.
Small markets are just good for the community because it provides them with a source where they can get healthy food, where they don't have to always go to the grocery store. And right now, a lot of people, they don't want to go to the grocery store because they're scared of people being too close with them, getting the COVID, getting just the whole social distancing thing. People feel a lot safer coming to the small markets.
This amazing market is supported by a partnership between the LSU Ag Center and the Southern University Ag Center. There's also a great program there that matches dollars spent with free tokens using SNAP benefits. You can visit the St. Helena Farmers Market each Friday from 8 a.m. until 1 p.m. You can learn more on our website at twilatv.org. Another product you'll often find at farmers markets is local citrus. In this week's Ag Minute, our friends at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum teach us about some less common uses for some everyday citrus favorites.
Hi, I'm Liz Williams. I'm the founder of the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. Today we're going to talk about Louisiana citrus. We are really, really lucky in Louisiana to have such a bounty of citrus. We have kumquats, we have oranges and lemons, we have satsumas, all kinds of things that our climate really supports. So one of the things I want to talk about is that we really should use the whole fruit. So if you're using kumquats, they're not just pretty little things. They taste wonderful and they make a great marmalade. They're also really good if you soak them in bourbon or vodka to make a delicious liqueur. Our oranges are great for juice, but also the peels are really wonderful for making all kinds of delicious things. You can candy them, or you can grind them up after you dry them and make a wonderful orange dust. Thanks so much for watching, and come visit us at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum.
That citrus liqueur does sound tasty, but maybe later when I'm not on set. To learn more about the Southern Food and Beverage Museum, head to our website, twilatv.org, and you can learn more there. And if you happen to visit, let them know that Twila sent you. With winter weather moving across much of Louisiana right now, it's a good time to warm up with hot boiled crawfish. Whether you're boiling it yourself or taking it home, things are definitely heating up across the state. We're going first to start out in Lake Charles, which is now 6 months out from Hurricane Laura. Things are looking better there, but I know all of the crawfish farmers in the area affected by the hurricanes could definitely use a boost in sales. Boulay's Boil and Go on Ruth Street in Lake Charles has them for $4.25 a pound live and $5.99 for boiled. In New Orleans, Michael's Seafood on Jefferson Highway has crawfish for $3.89 a pound live and $4.39 boiled. Randall's Fine Meats on Fink's Hideaway Road in Monroe has crawfish live for $3.95 a pound and $5.99 a pound for boiled. Before you venture out into the cold, be sure to check online or by phone for the latest prices. They can change a little bit even day to day. These crawfish prices are brought to you by our friends at the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board, which always reminds you to ask before you eat. Still to come on Twila, we're heading out to catch some oysters. Bring them back, shuck them, and fry them up to put together a great po' boy. A brand new Field to Feast is next. Stay with us.
Welcome to Field to Feast, where we profile Louisiana and its local ingredients. Today, we're in Empire, Louisiana, and on this glorious day, we're with Tezvich Oyster Tours. We're about to take the tour, learn all about oyster harvesting, and then enjoy some of this delicious Louisiana seafood.
Field to Feast with Jennifer Finley is brought to you by the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board. Louisiana Crawfish, ask before you eat. And by the Louisiana Beef Industry Council. Beef is what's for dinner. And by the Louisiana Rice Promotion Board. Think rice.
Let's just start, Matt, and tell me a little bit about where we are and what you have going on out here.
So we are down in Empire, Louisiana. A lot of people would call this oyster country. So there's a lot of oyster harvesters here, but we're trying out something new. It's called Tezvich Oyster Tours. So we'll take you out on the boat. It only lasts a couple hours. And not only do we teach you all about, I mean, I can bore you to death, all the things we're gonna teach you, but we not only do you do that, but we actually shuck them for you fresh on the way in, and you can't get any fresher. And we're the first ones to offer something like this, so we are very excited. The few families we took out, they seem to be loving it.
I am so excited, mostly to eat them.
Oh, this week's so beautiful. Yeah.
When people find out I'm an oyster fisherman, they automatically think that I'm way cooler than I actually am. So it's a win-win for me. I'm like, yeah, you're dang right I'm an oyster fisherman. We're about to drop the dredge and get some oysters up here for you to see.
To see and to eat.
To see, to eat, to clean. You're the oyster fisherman today.
Fisherwoman.
That's about 200 pounds. I know it didn't look 200 pounds.
We'll make sure to include that, everybody. Right. That was 200 pounds.
Yeah, it was a 200-pound dredge. You know, no big deal.
I got that. No big deal.
Yeah. It might even be 400 pounds. Who's counting?
We have been getting the best remarks. I mean, it's incredible. Matthew jokes because one of his friends from his gym said, man, are y'all paying people for these reviews you're getting on Facebook? And we're like, no, that would have been kind of smart to do if we weren't getting some good remarks.
These were rocks we put about 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago. And
wow.
You're gonna see it makes We have a variety of oysters, but you're gonna see the rocks. We pull up like a nice half shell, like 3.5-inch to 4-inch oyster. Let's check out what we have.
I'm so excited!
Sometimes the oysters, they come up clean. So this, you don't have to do anything with.
Right.
This, and it probably looks very familiar with. This is the stuff you see in restaurants. This is a great half shell product. So that goes straight in the basket. Sometimes they can grow real ugly like this. So these are two long oysters with these mussels covering it. Take a hatchet right there, and then we use that blade end to hit the mussels off. And then we use, if you come up on a rock, we'll actually use the hammer end for that. There you go. Perfect. Now pick it up a little bit so it has room to come off. Perfect. Now you just shave those mussels off. And I didn't even have to tell you the blade end. You already got it.
I'm telling you, I was meant to do this. I was born to be an oyster fisherwoman. In need of a hair tie.
All right, how are we doing?
I don't know. What do you think? How'd I do?
They look pretty good. That's some nice looking oysters to me.
Well, I'm getting very hungry. So we're going to take these oysters back to Rocco's Po' Boys in Baton Rouge and make ourselves a delicious oyster po' boy.
Sounds good.
Yay! We're back from a beautiful day out on the water, harvesting oysters for the dinner table. We're here at Rocco's New Orleans-style po' boys in Baton Rouge, and we're gonna head inside and eat some of that delicious seafood.
Talk to me a little bit about being from New Orleans and the taste. Is it different?
You know, one of the things that I think has always differentiated us from everybody else is the authenticity of our product. You're not gonna get a product like this anywhere else in Baton Rouge or for the state for that matter. Like I said before, in order to make a great New Orleans po' boy, you gotta be from New Orleans. I'm from there, and this is the end result, a fantastic New Orleans oyster po' boy with Ted's Fish oysters. So first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna dump our oysters into our egg wash. Make sure we get a good dip, make sure they're all fully coated, and then for that, straight into the cream meal. So we're gonna make sure that we cover each and every oyster very, very well. And then we go straight to the fryer with that.
We spent a beautiful day out on the water harvesting these oysters. And the only reason I knew about this particular company was because you had your son's birthday party. Talk to me about that.
That's correct. So I'm from, like I said, from Southeast Louisiana. I've been growing up, I had a camp in Shell Beach when I was a kid. So I know all the oyster fishermen in Belle Chasse, and on the other side, so you have the West Bank, which is Belle Chasse, and then you have the East Bank, which is Lower St. Bernard, Wyklowski, Shell Beach, down the road, we call it. And then I hooked up with Matt, and I said, man, I heard you're doing these tours. I said, it would be a great idea if we could take the boys out and show them a little bit about how we harvest oysters. And they had a fantastic time. It was so much fun. The best part about it was seeing these 10-year-old boys trying to eat oysters. That was absolutely hilarious. We had 10. Half ate them and half spit them off the side of the boat. But we were batting 500, so I'll take that any day. So we want to lay them out when we put them in the basket. We don't want to stack them on top of each other. Make sure we get an even fry with all of the oysters. Then we drop them in the grease. That's smell-o-vision, my friend.
I love it. Talk to me a little bit about some of your other menu items. You use fresh, local Louisiana ingredients, and it's crawfish season.
Correct. You know, we wholesale crawfish. We also boil crawfish during crawfish season.
Awesome.
And sell them in front of the restaurant. So you could just roll by, pick up 10 pounds and roll out. You don't even have to get out your car, curbside service, which everybody's doing now. Today we're obviously featuring our crawfish etouffee, or our soup du jour of the day. And it's gonna be a cup or bowl. And that's also made with fresh Louisiana crawfish. Again, everything we buy is locally sourced and Louisiana proud. You know, we're at a time where it's extremely important to support your local businesses. And the oyster and fishermen down in St. Bernard, Belle Chasse, across the South, need your help more now than anything. And also small businesses like myself. We drive the economy. The small businesses are the ones that are suffering right now. Please get out and go support your local businesses. The greatest thing that I can ever tell you is there's nothing like bringing somebody in to your establishment, if it's a restaurant, treating them as a guest, like they're dining in your own home, and watching them enjoy a great authentic product like the Oyster Po' Boy.
Speaking of, if you don't mind, thank you so much for having us today, but this is just
truly
screaming
my pleasure.
My name.
Eat up.
Dig in. Ooh, my goodness. Are you going to have the other half?
Can I have a bite?
Oh, amen.
Let me try it out.
Field to Feast with Jennifer Finley was brought to you by the Louisiana Crawfish Promotion and Research Board. Louisiana Crawfish, ask before you eat. And by the Louisiana Beef Industry Council. Beef, it's what's for dinner. And by the Louisiana Rice Promotion Board. Think rice.
Some farmers are very, very good at herding cows. For some, it's even a form of art. In this week's TWILA Boost, we introduce you to Farmer Derek, a Kansas cattleman who transforms his herd into creative masterpieces.
Y'all, this is Farmer Derek. We need more cow art! This one took 300 cattle, 4 farmers, a drone, and a feed truck. Okay, go Grant. Lost his hat. Are they flying? Oh, it's like, what is that? Oh, that's my drone. That was a good one. That one was legit.
Nothing like cow art. Well, that does it for this edition of TWILA. We have a very exciting show in store for you next week. You may see some fresh faces here on the set. You need to tune in to see what happens. Until then, you can watch all of our stories online at twilatv.org and be sure to like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram. You can also find all of these stories and more on our YouTube channel. Be sure to subscribe and turn on notifications so you know when we put out new stuff. For all of us here at TWILA, thanks for joining us. We hope to see you again right here next week.